If you add lithium aluminum hydride to a carboxylic acid, and in your workup add a source of protons, you can reduce your carboxylic acid to an alcohol. And so if you think about the oxidation state of this carbon, if you assigned one, that's this carbon over here on your alcohol. And if you assign an oxidation state here, you'll see there's been a decrease in the oxidation state, so there's been a reduction. So lithium aluminum hydride is one way to reduce a carboxylic acid. You could also accomplish this with borane, and borane is actually more chemoselective, and so we'll talk about that at the end of the video. For right now, let's focus in on the possible mechanism of lithium aluminum hydride reacting with our carboxylic acid. So let's go ahead and redraw our carboxylic acid. So I'm going to go ahead and put in our carbonyl. And then we know the acidic proton on our carboxylic acid is the one on the oxygen. Lithium aluminum hydride can be a strong base. So I'm going to go ahead and draw in. All right, so aluminum with four bonds to hydrogen, giving it a -1 formal charge. And then we have our lithium, Li plus, like that. So a hydride, we know, is a hydrogen with two electrons. And we know that's a strong base. So you could think about these two electrons here taking this proton and leaving these two electrons behind on your oxygen. All right, so an acid-base reaction is probably the first step of this mechanism. So if you take a proton from a carboxylic acid, you're left with the conjugate base, which is the carboxylate anion. So a -1 formal charge on this oxygen, and we could follow those electrons. So these electrons in magenta move on to this oxygen to form our carboxylate anion. Right, lithium is present, so it's probably going to bond with that oxygen. And we would also form hydrogen gas, right? So we would form H2. So let's show those electrons, right? So these electrons in blue, right, can pick up this proton. So that forms H2, hydrogen gas. And then we took a bond away from the aluminum. So the aluminum is now only bonded to three hydrogens, and that takes away its formal charge. So formal charge of 0 now on the aluminum. So now that we've formed our carboxylate anion, that's going to react with AlH3. So let's go ahead and draw in our carboxylate anion here. So we have our carbonyl, we have our R group, and we have our oxygen with three lone pairs of electrons, so -1 formal charge. So next, our AlH3 comes along. So this is just one of the possibilities for the mechanism. All right, and we're going to form a bond between the oxygen here and the aluminum, and we're going to form a bond between the carbon and the hydrogen. So if we think about these electrons in red right here, this carbon, right, is partially positive because the oxygen is withdrawing some electron density from it. So these electrons in here could move in to form a bond. And at the same time, right, these electrons in blue here can move out to form a bond between the oxygen and the aluminum. So let's go ahead and show the result of that. So we would now have our carbon would be tetrahedral, right? So let's draw it like this. We would have a bond to this hydrogen right here. So the electrons in red move in here to form this bond. And then that carbon is still bonded to an oxygen with three lone pairs of electrons, so it still has a -1 formal charge like that. And then we would have our carbon bonded to this oxygen. This oxygen has two lone pairs of electrons on it, and we just formed a bond to the aluminum. So the electrons in blue form our bond here, and the aluminum is still bonded to two hydrogens. We can go ahead and draw on those two hydrogens. All right, if we take these electrons and move them in here to form our double bond, we would have to push these electrons off onto our oxygen. And so we would have our oxygen bonded to the aluminum, and we have these two hydrogens here, and so the oxygen would now have three lone pairs of electrons, giving it a -1 formal charge. And so the lithium is probably now going to bond to this oxygen, and we just reformed our carbonyl, right? So let's go ahead and show that. So we would form our carbonyl here like that, and then we have this hydrogen. So let's show some of those electrons, right? So if I say that these electrons in green here on this oxygen move in to form our carbonyl, all right? And then we had the electrons in red, right? So this hydrogen is this hydrogen, and so we form an aldehyde. And so we have an aldehyde, and we have excess lithium aluminum hydride, and the lithium aluminum hydride is going to transfer a hydride to our aldehyde. So we can go ahead and reduce our aldehyde with another lithium aluminum hydride. So I'm going to draw that in. So we have lithium aluminum hydride, Right, so negative one formal charge on the aluminum. Right, our carbonyl is polarized, so partially negative oxygen, partially positive carbon right here. And so once again, we can think about these electrons. So these electrons right here from attacking this carbon, right, pushing these electrons in green off onto the oxygen. So let's get some more room. Right, so to show what happens here. So this is what we've seen in earlier videos here. All right, so now we would have our carbon, right, bonded to an oxygen. This oxygen now has three lone pairs of electrons. So one of those lone pairs were the ones in green, right? So draw those in here like that, giving that a negative one formal charge. All right, we're going to form a bond between carbon and hydrogen. So I'm going to show that. Let's use blue here. So these electrons, right, and this hydrogen, right, are a hydride. So lithium aluminum hydride acts as a hydride transfer agent and transfers these two electrons and this hydrogen, right, to our carbon. And then we still had this carbon in red here. This hydrogen, right, bonded to the carbon in red like that. And then we had our R group here. All right, so in the final step, right, we would just protonate our alk oxide, right? So we could add something like dilute acid in our workup here. So if we add a dilute acid, H3O+, right, let me go ahead and draw that in. Then our alk oxide could pick up a proton, right, leaving these electrons behind. So protonating our alk oxide would yield our alcohol as our product. So let me go ahead and draw those in. So we would have those two hydrogens, right? We have an OH, and then we would have an R group. And so that's one of the possibilities for the reduction of a carboxylic acid with lithium aluminum hydride, with the end result of transferring two hydrides, right? So the one in so this hydrogen and these electrons, right? And then also this hydrogen and these electrons both came from lithium aluminum hydride. And the mechanism is definitely more complicated than the one I showed you, but this is a simple way to think about it. All right, let's look at a practice problem. So if we had this compound over here on the left, and we added lithium aluminum hydride and a source of protons in our workup, we just talked about it, the fact that it would reduce a carboxylic acid. And we have a ketone present here as well. And we've seen in earlier videos that lithium aluminum hydride will reduce the ketone as well and turn that into an alcohol on our workup. So when we draw the product, all right, we have our benzene ring. And we would turn that ketone into a secondary alcohol, as we've seen before. And then the carboxylic acid here would turn into a primary alcohol. So let's show some of these carbons, right? So this carbon right here is this carbon. And then let's do this carbon right here in red, right, is this carbon. So we reduced both functional groups using lithium aluminum hydride. If we did this reaction with borane, so BH3 instead, borane is actually chemoselective for the carboxylic acid group only. So it's only going to reduce this. So if we draw the product using borane, we would have our benzene ring. And the borane wouldn't touch the ketone. So that is left here. It would reduce the carboxylic acid. So we would turn that into a primary alcohol. And so once again, this carbon in red is this carbon. So borane is considered to be a little bit better sometimes because of its ability to be chemoselective, right? It will only reduce your carboxylic acid group in this case, and that's very beneficial sometimes when you're not looking to reduce other parts of your molecule.